Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick. Hope you guys are doing all right. Praise the Lord. I just wanted to say, you know, that for whatever reason, brothers and sisters, since I hit the States in May, I've been just, you know, the enemy's been coming in like a flood in every direction. But about the last 3 days, brothers and sisters, now the thing about it is, I want to say this for you guys. Lots of times, we can get mad or we can get glad about the circumstances we see in the natural, brothers and sisters, what we see in the natural. And I just want to say this right now. In the natural, things for me are really unchanged. They're really unchanged. But for the last 3 days, I know I've got a breakthrough. The tide has turned spiritually. I've been under this attack. I know the enemy, you know, for me personally, and you know, got you guys going through stuff too. That's why I'm telling you about it. I know for me personally, you know, the Lord doesn't want, the enemy doesn't want me to finish the race. Satan and his, you know, his minions, they don't want me to run the race that God called me to run. And I know that the Lord has things for me to do for him to finish the race. And, you know, I've set my face like flint to go up on his mountain, to Mount Zion, to the spiritual Mount Zion. Sometimes that's a literal, but definitely the spiritual one from Hebrews chapter 12, to the church of the firstborn, to the multitude of angels, to those who have died and gone on before us, the saints in heaven, you know, to the Lord Jesus Christ himself and even God the Father, to be there at Mount Zion with the Lord, to enter into his kingdom, literally be there with him. So I'm determined to finish the race, to go up the mountain into the presence of God. You know, and brothers and sisters, that's what you have to do. You have to set your face like flint, like Jesus did in Luke. You know, he went through Samaria again. You know, one time he went to Samaria before, and he, you know, there's the woman at the well and all that. It's in John chapter 4. But another time when he was getting ready to go to his passion, he was about to go up to Jerusalem. And when they say go up to Jerusalem, it's because Jerusalem is about over 2,000 feet. And all those other places are down there at sea level, and even down at the Dead Sea, it's below sea level. But so when people use the expression going up to Jerusalem, just a FYI here, as the Lord has just arrested me on that point, it's a literal elevation climb. But also, that's, you know, God also did that, you know, metaphorically. Going to Mount Zion, you're going up, you know, into the presence of God, out of the flesh and into the spirit realms. Just like Moses went up and got the Ten Commandments. It's like when we're raptured, we're going up. Even though heaven is not just right there in the sky, but going up represents going up above the flesh, up above this fallen world. Is the, you know, is the meaning that God's trying to get across to us. The, you know, the idea of being above humanity, above the things of this world. Anyway, brothers and sisters, those ascension psalms, the Lord had told me a few years ago, you know, read the ascension psalms. And they're, you know, the psalms are actually songs. When Jesus and his disciples read at the Passover, they read some psalms and sang some hymns and all that. They were reading the, singing the psalms. And there's ascension psalms. And there's different, you can look that up, Google it, and find out which ones are those. There's psalms they sang as they were going up to Jerusalem, literally going up and spiritually going up to the temple. Brothers and sisters, we should be going up to that house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. We should be going up to see our Maker, going up to see our Lord and our God and his Christ. Hallelujah. And the Lord gave me a word tonight, and it's from a Bible verse, Isaiah 12:2. Isaiah 12:2. Now, yesterday when I was praying, as I said, I know that I've got a turn. There's been a turn in the Spirit, and things are flowing in the river of God through the ministry again. And for whatever reason, it wasn't for about 2 months since I've been in the States. The enemy's been attacking me in all directions in the ministry. But I haven't seen it in the natural yet. But the flow has already been reversed for the last 3 days, 4 days, because the Lord has pruned the ministry and got, you know, got us free from all the things that needed to be set free from the ministry. The Lord's already done that. Everything's good to go. The Lord is about to break forth his Spirit through Joshua's ministry in a whole new thing. And I believe, and I've been praying and believe in the name of the Lord, that it is revival in the United States. The Lord would use me to bring revival to the churches, brothers and sisters. Some of those are we, as we gather in the Lord's name, we are the church. There's buildings where people meet. That's also called the church. There's lots of buildings where people meet. They call themselves a church, but they're not part of the church, right? They're not part of the bride of Christ. But anyway, brothers and sisters, the Lord gave me this from Isaiah 12, 2. And yesterday when I was praying with my wife, the last 3 days, one way I know that things have turned, I mean, the Lord told me, I know it's going. And then when I pray, there's a fresh wind, a fresh flow of the Spirit for the last 3 days. You know, there's people that, you know, play mind games with me and all that. I don't know why, you know, the devil keeps trying to do that to me. But the Spirit of the Lord is flowing. The Spirit of the Lord is flowing. And those and all of those things are washed away, no matter what. You know, those, as the Bible says, you know, we can read the Bible. It can be theoretical to us. It's legitimate and it's real and it's true. And it is truth. And then when we set our faith upon that mustard seed of faith, and then God begins to move. It's just like, I'm trying to switch gears up on you, actually. I'm trying to talk about different things. You know me, brothers and sisters. I always do that. Jesus said in Mark chapter 11, verse 22, 23, and 24, when Peter said, you know, after Jesus had cursed the fig tree, why? Because it didn't bear fruit. That was a metaphoric representation of what he was about to do to Israel. And also for us. Every tree that does not bear fruit should be cut up and thrown into the fire, John the Baptist said. That's a revival message. That's a revival message, all you greasy gracers out there who believe you can say a prayer when you're 8 years old, live like the devil the rest of your life, and go to heaven and bear no fruit. Anyway, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks, the Lord said. So whatever's coming out of your mouth, whatever you're saying, it's what's in your heart. You can't go around talking bad about the Lord and all this stuff and talking about you're a Christian and the same, you know, bitter and sweet water coming out of the same well, as James said. Anyway, brothers and sisters, Jesus said in Mark chapter 11, after he cursed the fig tree, and Peter's like, wow, Lord, look, this tree you cursed, it's already dead the next morning. And Jesus said, have faith in God. He said, for whomsoever, that's anybody, who shall say to this tree, say to this mountain, be thou removed and cast in the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart those things that he saith, but believes the things that he saith when he says it, he shall have whatsoever he saith. So the most important word in there is to say. And the second one is to believe when you say it. You know, and that's a video on faith. Let me touch on that a little bit. Since I'm going with that, the Lord is leading me on that message when I'm trying to talk about the word that the Lord gave me. God is my salvation, not our salvation. God is my salvation, or Christ is my salvation, is exactly what the Lord told me. That's what I want to tell you guys. Yesterday he had given me that, and I was praying in the Spirit. And I kept saying, I didn't recognize the word. It was a Hebrew word, and it was the name I can't say it in my natural tongue, but I was saying El Yeshita, or something like Yeshute, something like that. And that is the Hebrew for that from Isaiah 12, 2, God is my salvation. There's other times where it says God is our salvation. God is my salvation, Isaiah 12, 2. And the Lord told me, though, today, the interpretation he was giving for what I had said in tongues yesterday was, Christ is my salvation. So the Lord is our salvation. He is the one who saves us. And I want to do another video on that next time as the Lord leads me. But salvation is not just going to heaven. You know, it means to heal, to deliver, to set free. You know, salvation is not just, oh, I'm going to heaven when I die. Those whom the Son sets free, Jesus said, are free indeed. You know, we're not a slave anymore to sin. We're not a slave anymore to this world. You know, that includes physical healing, all the things, deliverance from captivity, all those different things, you know, that drug addictions, whatever may be in our life. The Lord has set us free from all those things. He set us free from death, hell, and the grave, the world, the flesh, and the devil. He set us free from those things. We are free in Christ. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Now, I know the Lord's going to connect this in with the other faith message that I'm giving at the same time from Mark chapter 11. You know, I'm just laughing because I always do this, and the Lord always gives me like kind of two different topics and then they come together. So I'm just laughing because, you know, I always do those messages by faith. You know, just the Lord gives it to me and it just flows. And we can all do these things, not necessarily you that everyone's going to do a message like what I'm doing, but God can bring those things together and the things that he called you to do, whether it's evangelism, witnessing to your neighbor or your coworkers, whether it's, you know, bringing together, you know, to send a box of clothes to the orphans in the Philippines, whatever it is, God can bring it together, and he will bring it together as you allow him to lead you by his Spirit. So faith, Faith is the evidence of things not seen, the substance of things hoped for, and the evidence of things not seen. That's King James words 11:1. Hebrews 11:1. Hebrews 11:7. For without faith, it's impossible to please God. And he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. So God is not pleased with lack of faith. The only way to please God, without faith, it's impossible to please God. So you have to have faith to please God. He's just looking for that mustard seed of faith. That mustard seed, just a small drop of faith and belief. As a matter of fact, the Bible says one of the people who will not enter the kingdom of heaven is the fearful, people full of doubt and unbelief. You cannot be a Christian if you're filled with doubt and unbelief. It takes faith to be saved. By grace are you saved through faith. Everybody loves to keep talking about grace. But it says, by grace are you saved through faith. You have to believe. It's not of your own, but a gift of God. The grace is the gift of God. The faith. Them old greasy graces try to say that Jesus is, Paul is talking about faith. It's a special gift of faith. No. The Bible says to every man. Paul also said to every man is dealt the measure of faith. We all have faith. The gift of faith is a supernatural gift of faith that God would use. Faith of the Lord would come on you to build an ark for a flood. The faith of the Lord would come on you to walk on water. The faith of the Lord would come on you to raise the dead. Something like that for some mighty miracle that was just way signs and wonders, to call down fire from heaven or something. It's a supernatural anointing of faith. Not like the regular faith that every man's been dealt to be saved. To believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. As the Bible tells us, Romans chapter 10. All who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Anyway, brothers and sisters, so in that text where Paul's talking about, and Jesus is talking in Hebrew, Mark chapter 11, verse 22, 23, and 24, he says, you have the faith of God. Listen to what he says. I need to do a whole video on that. I'm just dropping these nuggets, and I need to do a video on each one. You know how I am. I'm just putting out, and the Lord is just flowing, and I want to get it out there instead of having all these cute little notes, but those who listen to my videos, they get it. What I'm saying, Jesus said, have the faith of God. Have faith in God. Have the faith of God. What did God do? We're supposed to be imitators of Paul, imitators of Christ, following Christ. Jesus said, greater works than these shall you do because I go to the Father. What did God do? He said, let there be light. And there was light. God spoke it, and it was. Romans chapter 4, God calls those things that are not as if they are. So he told Abram, which means like a father. He said, I'm going to start calling you Abraham. Your name is now Abraham, father of many nations. He just changed his name. So when people said his name, hey, father of many nations. Abraham was childless, 75. His wife was 65, and he was a childless man. That's when they got all this crazy idea to have, after 10 years of waiting, and God didn't fulfill that promise of when he changed his name at 75, Then Abraham said, and his wife said, Sarai, she said, well, why don't you just sleep with my servant, my bondservant, Hagar? So they tried to fulfill God's word in their own idea. Of course, that's how we got all this big mess in the Middle East right now, because of that stupid idea. I always laugh about it because it says that when Sarah told Abraham that, Abraham didn't argue with her. He's like, okay. Yeah, I'll sleep with your servant. She didn't have to twist his arm, So Abraham did it. And then, though, after Hagar was pregnant, Sarai got mad, and she said that, this woman's, she's despising me, and I'm her boss, so she's my servant. She got arrogant because she was going to have the child of Abraham, who's the boss. And so then, Abraham, instead of defending Hagar, he said, well, do whatever you want to with her. That's the culture of the Middle East. They treated her like a dog. And, it's a sad story. The story of Hagar is a sad story if you read it. The way she was treated by Sarai. But that's the culture that they lived in at that time, brothers and sisters. But it's a sad situation. And then Sarai even had Ishmael sent away, because Isaac was the son of promise, and then Sarah, her name had been changed to Sarah at that time by the Lord. She's like, she's saying that, this boy Ishmael is jealous of my son. He might try to kill Isaac so he can get the blessing. So Abraham sent him away. And that's really the root of all the promise going on in the Middle East now. The root was because Abram and Sarai, they tried to fulfill God's promise. When he's going to be the one to do it. He said, you'll be the father of many nations. God would be the one to cause it to happen. Those guys tried to cause it to happen themselves. That's a whole other message I'm getting into. Let me just say it in this video quickly. There's lots of my videos I need to go back and get into each section and make a whole video out of it. But the little lesson there is that God gives us a word. God gives us a promise. You know, we feel led by the Lord to speak. You know, God, you know, be like what God did when he changed his name to Abraham. We speak, as Jesus said, stand to this mountain, be removed, cast into the sea. So you go out and proclaiming and by faith in Jesus' name that God's going to make a way for you to get a job if you need a job, whatever it is. God's going to make a way for you to get a vehicle if you don't have a vehicle. You know, and like me in the ministry, I need a vehicle, or we need finances for the orphanage. You know, we need to meet the budget for the orphanage, and it's almost time that, you know, we have to buy the food for the orphans. And I would pray and proclaim, I know God's going to provide a way. You know, I was just talking to a brother about that this afternoon. There's lots of people who, and I mentioned this before, they have theoretical faith, but they've never really been through anything. Not just like, you know, myself, with being a missionary in a foreign country for the last 7 years, I did it for over 7 years. But people who've got cancer, there are people, brothers and sisters, who I've prayed with and talked to, who've been healed from cancer, who've been through something. You know what I mean? They've been given a diagnosis of terminal cancer, and they've been healed. They prayed and believed, and I prayed for them, and they prayed for them. They had other people pray for them, and all this, and they were healed, and they're still alive. They've been through something. But most of the people, you've never been through nothing. Thank God you've never been through nothing. You know, you've never been outside out of your own front yard for the name of Jesus. You know? So, this wasn't me and this brother was talking about. I want to put this in here as I'm talking about this. You have got to start somewhere. You've got to start somewhere. As the old saying goes, how do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. You know, you've got to start somewhere, oh ye of little faith, and you have to build your faith and build your trust and confidence in the Lord. You know, as I said, every man's been dealt the measure of faith. You've been born again. You know, a newborn baby doesn't go out here and start driving a car the next day. First, you got to learn to walk, talk, learn to eat, feed yourself, get off of baby milk on a solid food, learn how to feed yourself, get potty trained, whatever, all those things, get out of diapers, go to school. Then later on, you're driving a car, become an adult. Same process with following the Lord. The problem with most people, lots of people. Now, lots of you guys I know, just like me, you're not going to a regular church because none of the churches are teaching the Word of God. They're backslidden churches. They're telling a bunch of stuff that's not biblical. They're environmental churches. They're all this other kind of stuff. You know, having the Pope, bringing in all this doctrine from the old Babylonian mystery religions, from the Vatican and all this, with the latest thing going on, denying the virgin birth, all this stuff that these denominations are doing. But there's lots of people who don't go to church, brothers and sisters, because they don't want to be corrected. They don't want to be discipled. That's another thing I was talking to that brother about today. You don't know how many people contact me. They got saved this week. And they're going to go be Elijah. They've been called to be Elijah and move to Israel next week. I've had people that contacted me and said, brother, the Lord told me that you're supposed to give me all the money from Joshua's ministry so I can fly to Jerusalem and evangelize people. And God told me to tell you that. I've had lots of people tell me that. They just got saved this last week. They saw a video on YouTube. They got saved. They've got a date for the rapture, and they're Elijah, and they're going to Israel. Now, you know how many people I've seen doing that. But anyway, brothers and sisters, I'm getting off topic. I would say it's connected to this topic and the fact that there's faith in God and the things of God and doing what God's going to do. And there's also God's timing. That's what I'm trying to tell you. That's the things I deal with people. There's lots of people that don't have any faith. And they've been defeated and beat down. Here they are beat down and they don't have the faith to believe for God and press through until the season of being beat down, like I've just myself, coming out of a season of attack, a valley, coming out of that. God put me through that because he was separating things in the ministry and all this kind of stuff that the Lord's been doing, all these different things God's been doing. And he's pruning the ministry to go forward. And I already know that and recognize that, you know, as my time with the Lord in 14 years in the ministry, I recognize the way God operates. But there are tons of people who the Lord has showed them they're going to do something, but they want to do it today and not go through all those pruning processes and all that. That's where faith comes in. Faith, the problem with lots of people, like Jesus said, this parable of the sower, you know, a little bit of tribulation comes on in the little growth plant that was sown by the Lord, by the Holy Spirit, it doesn't have any roots, so it chokes and it withers and dies when it gets into a dry season. And you know, Joseph went through, and this I was mentioned about Abraham. Abraham was 75 when he was promised by God he'd be the father of many nations. He was 100 when Isaac was born. He was 99 when his wife got pregnant. So 25 years, and she was 90, and he was 100 when Isaac was born. So it was impossible unless God had done it. You know, so God had restored them both physically to have a child. The Bible even goes on to say that after Sarah died, Abraham had more wives and had more kids up till he was 175 years old. He was still reproducing. I mean, God, that's a whole other lesson. When God restores you, he really restores you. Abraham was restored from God all the way till he died at 175. You know, that's, you know, who's, it's even unheard of, a 100-year-old person being able to reproduce, you know, because of physical deterioration. And here's Abraham, by a miracle of God, you know, God really made a way. Did what he said he was going to do. But it wasn't when he was 75. It's 25 years later, brothers and sisters. So, like Joseph, he had a dream when he was a teenager, when he was about 17, that he was going to, his family was going to bow down to him. He went through all this process. He was about 30 years old when it finally came true. So it was, you know, when the 7 years of famine began, and his family bowed down to him. That's been a long time since I calculated out the years. So I would say, I guess he was about 37, maybe, when that 7 years of famine was over. So you're talking about 20 years from the time Joseph had his dream until it became a reality. You know, but in the meantime, God had given Joseph that dream that everyone, his siblings, would bow down to him, so that that would sustain him. That would give him the faith, because he didn't have the Bible back then. The Bible wasn't written until Moses wrote down the Old Testament. It's like 450 years after the life of Joseph. So he only had that word that God gave him, and the words he had heard from his great-grandfather Abraham, and then Isaac and Jacob, the promises of God to his family. That's the only word he had. So he was sustained by those dreams through that 20 years in the pit to the palace. But he went from the pit to the palace in one day, but he had 20 years of hell in between. And that's how, generally speaking, that's how the things of God operates. God puts us through the fire, through the test. He's the potter, we're the clay. We go through those processes. But it's the faith to proclaim and declare victory all the way through the situation. And brothers and sisters, that's what I've been doing about this vehicle. Now, there's, you know, I haven't gotten a vehicle yet. I got this RV to drive temporarily. And, I've had, all along since I've been in ministry, there's lots of people that tell me things, and then you see how it goes. You know, nothing's guaranteed. The only thing guaranteed is the Lord. The Lord is our provider. Jehovah Jireh, God is our provider. And I know that God will provide, as an example in this situation, God will provide a vehicle for me to do the ministry in the United States. God will provide the budget for Joshua's ministry. I know he will. It's his ministry. The orphanages are his orphanages. And I know the budget will be there. I know that God will provide. He's Jehovah Jireh. Just like I know that I'm saved. Christ is my salvation. Isaiah 12:2. I know that God is my salvation. I know that God is my provider, Jehovah Jireh. I know that he is my peace, Jehovah Shalom. I know that he's my healer, you know, Jehovah Rapha, all those things. I know God is with me, Emmanuel. God is with me. God is with us. He's my peace. He's my deliverer. He's my banner, Jehovah Nissi. I know that God will do all things in me, to me, and through me. And in him, we live and breathe and have our being. God will make a way. Not he can make a way. When I first became a pastor, and they were selling that CDs on TV, you know, that Don Moen. You know, God will make a way. In the Philippines, boy, they love Don Moen. They love real sweet people. You know, Don Moen's just so sweet. And Don Moen, when I first heard that song, I bought those CDs off TV. As a matter of fact, my mom asked me what I want for Christmas. That's when I first dedicated my life to the Lord. I said, I want that Don Moen thing. They bought it for me for Christmas. And I was singing that song when I first got it. You know, God can make a way. I don't know why I kept saying that. And then I was like, it says God will make a way. Not he can't make a way. He will make a way. You know, rivers in the desert will I see. Heaven and earth may fade, but his love will still remain. He will do something new today. God will make a way where there seems to be no way. He'll make a way for you. He's the way maker. But you got to believe. You got to have faith. You got to put your faith and trust in the Lord from salvation all the way to the grave. Every day on you're on this earth, it's a walk that's by faith. As long as you're in the flesh, you will have tribulation. Not the tribulation. People read that Bible verse and say, oh, we're all going through tribulation because Jesus said, in this life, you'll have tribulation. Can you believe that people... I don't know where these people come from, man. They think they're theologians. And Jesus said, in this life, you will have tribulation. Every person that ever lives will have tribulation in their life, not the tribulation. If Jesus would be a liar then, if it means the tribulation, all those people need to come back to life that's lived since Jesus said it and go through the tribulation period. What? Come on, man. Come on. Use your noodle, man. Jesus is Christ. Jesus is the Christ. He's on the throne and he reigns forevermore. God will make a way for me, for you, for Joshua's ministry, for all the things that God has created, all the things he's called forth, he will sustain. And that's what it is. As I was talking to the brother today, it's not our gifting. It's not about the gifting that we have from God, like a talent to make a video like I'm doing, a talent to be a house mom or dad at an orphanage, or the gifting to speak in tongues or whatever. It's not the gifting, but the high calling, as that text I started with when I made this video, to run the race with patience, to meet the high calling of Christ that's in our life. You have a calling in your life. I have a calling in my life. We are called to a high calling, to go up to Jerusalem. As I said in the beginning of this video, we got to go up. You got to go up the mountain of God. And what does it say? I will. It's from the Psalms, but most of you guys might not know it's a psalm because you didn't read your Bible. You think it's a song. But there's a song from the Psalms that says, I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad. You know, that's from the Psalms. So when we enter his gates, we're going to start praying with thanksgiving in our heart. Thank you, Lord. This is a day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Thank you, Lord, for that I'm still walking this earth. Thank you, Lord, that I'm able to walk. Thank you, Lord, that I've got my health. Thank you, Lord, that I've got electricity. Thank you, Lord, that I've got air conditioner, our heater, our electricity. I got a computer. Thank you, Lord, for my family, my children, my spouse, my dog, whatever it is you thank the Lord for it. Then enter his courts, going into the inner court with praise. That's a whole other video. I've laid out and covered 10 different videos I can make and go on down into it. I'm throwing it out there because you guys need to, you know, there's people that'll jump on one part of it and study it. This just seems to be the way the Lord uses me. You know, and then go on into the Holy of Holies. There's lots of you don't even get into that inner court because you don't have thanksgiving in your heart and you didn't get enter his courts with praise, much less get past that brazen altar of repentance. Well, the sacrifice of the blood is made, getting on into the holy place where the Word of God is, the bread of life is, and the light, the Holy Spirit, then are in on the final place, of course, the Holy of Holies. You know, soaking in the presence of the Most High God, receiving in yourself the Christ, the hope of glory. Hallelujah. He is our hope of glory. He's the Christ, the Son of the living God, Son of the Most High God, El Elyon, El Shaddai, God Almighty, the Christ, the living Christ. Hallelujah. Praise his name forevermore. God bless you guys. I will see you. I know the Lord's going to make a way to do all the things to finish the high calling that's in my life. And I pray in Joshua's ministry and the Church of the Firstborn. And I hope you, brothers and sisters, will have the faith of a mustard seed to answer the high calling of God in your life. Go run the race that's been set before you. Go run the race that God called you to do. Stop worrying about what everybody else is doing. Stop trying to run other people's races. Run your race with patience and endurance. He who endures until the end shall be saved. God bless you guys.